when I first came here, it was just after the war, after the siege, and it was very, very moving. I mean, it's still moving, but, you know, in the 90s, it was in the papers every day. This terrible, brutal siege that nobody in England really knew anything about, except they knew that the British were behaving badly, but that's quite normal. Generally, we're behaving badly. Started during the war, didn't it? So it started as a sort of note of defiance, and yeah, great. So that's why I came. I mean, it's like being a rock star. You think, oh, I see, this is what Rod Stewart has 6 nights a week. It's fantastic. I mean, it's the most wonderful place. First of all, real life is very, very interesting. And it seems to have got more interesting in some mysterious way. Yeah, that can't be right. But anyway, no, it is very, very interesting. And the two things have somehow elided. There's less real life in this film because to me it's like a Hollywood film from the 40s. What happened is I was asked to make the film. I read the script, listened to Florence on YouTube, and then I went to have lunch with the producers. And in the course of lunch I said, who do you want to play the part? And he said, Meryl Streep. I said, well, fine by me. Okay. Oh, okay. You know, what are you supposed to say? So it wasn't my idea. I can't pretend that. I never thought of who should play the part. In fact, I met her voice coach the other night. You take your hat off to him. You know, she went and did the work. She got it, got him hired, and for some weeks, by the time she came to England to play the part, she knew how to do it. Because people sort of change the course of their lives. They go to work with me as though I don't know any better and I'll let them do something which other people wouldn't. In other words, now, I would take full credit for casting Hugh Grant. That was me. I mean, I'd known Hugh. And I could see that Hugh has sort of changed his life. And if you said, well, he could see that with you, it wasn't a question of saying, well, can you do this because you did it so well in the past? It was something new. And I take the credit, I'd happily take the credit for that, but Helen was cast by somebody else. Dustin was cast by somebody else. Judy and Philomena was cast by somebody else. You know, it's hard to take. Dan was one of four, but the girls all said, oh, you want Dan. I know when I'm beaten. Jack Black came from, I mean, I agreed to some, he came from the suggestion of the boys who wrote High Fidelity. So that's the way it normally works. One of the lucky things about me is that I haven't seen those films. So I just see the chap I knew Hugh very slightly. And I'd always thought he was brilliant. So I don't have that sort of problem to overcome. Ignorance is a great source of strength. I didn't help him at all. Hugh, in his own way, is like Marlon Brando. Hugh is a method actor. You know, he goes and does the work. He doesn't look like Marlon Brando, and he doesn't go through all that performance that Brando would go through. But actually, he completely steeps himself in it. And then he'll come and ask you questions. Well, if it's this, then so and so and so and so. He's very, very intelligent, very, very conscientious, very hardworking. Everything he spent his life trying to pretend he wasn't. But he really is. And, you know, you just stand there like a sort of midwife. John Cusack and his two friends wrote a draft. And he rang me up and said, would you be interested in doing it? It's now set in Chicago. And I thought, what a stupid idea. And then I read the script. Then I reread the book and I realized that the script they'd written got you to the good bits of the book, which is really the interior monologues. And so I said, sure. Jack, I said, who should play? You know, there are these two boys in the record shop. I said, who should play this part? And they said, Jack Black. So Jack came to see me, and after a dance, he ended up in the film. He's a wonderful fellow. And then I remember thinking, oh, I see in England, that character is sort of like John Lennon, someone much more sour, much more sarcastic and bitter. And Jack is wonderfully sort of benign and lovable. John Lennon wasn't lovable, he was wonderful. But he was great in many, many ways. But that sort of easy charm and I thought, oh, how interesting, that's what they do, that's the difference between England and America. Or that's what's different in that character. All you're trying to do is get the best out of people. You can't make them something else. You can't take this person and turn him into that person. So it isn't like being Svengali or anything. Yeah. You can spend a lot of time thinking and trying to cast them right. So I would say that Jack was very, very well cast. It's only afterwards you sort of realize, oh, I see that this happened and this happened and this happened. That's all. Hugh, I sort of knew what Hugh was going to do. And it came as no surprise to me that he was so good. For the French composer I worked with said, get a pianist. Don't get an actor who can pretend. Get a pianist. And a casting director in New York said, the person you want is. So I went and met him and cast him. And he was so obviously a funny fellow. So in a way, you learn not to interfere. I'm about to make another film with Judi Dench. She's been acting for 2,000 years. I'm not going to be the one who says, oh, no, don't do it like this. If there's something that doesn't make any sense to you, you hold a perfectly intelligent conversation with her and say, well, that doesn't make any sense. But she knows how to act. Helen, I always thought Helen knew as much about the Queen as I did. I just go where the good writing is. If there's good writing there, I'll go there. I don't really give a damn about anything else. If it's good, and like you say, if the writing is good, you'll get the good actors.